be after worship and then followed by our administrative council meeting. Everyone is invited to come and stay and break bread and, you know, have a little meeting. Today is the last day we are collecting school supplies for our neighbors in need. Wednesday, choir rehearsal. No, no choir rehearsal. That's a missed title. No choir rehearsal. As a reminder, we have our mission with that money project, your box stops, education, your soda can tabs, your cancel postage stamps. Bring them to church by September 24. All this will go to Cambridge Elementary School. And United Methodist Women meeting in New Hope and Randolph, Virginia. The registration on lunch is $14. If you just want to go for the to hear the new bishop, it will be $3 for the registration. You may contact Susan Mosley. Do we have any birthdays, anniversaries to celebrate? Yeah, what are you celebrating? Your birthday? How old? Six years old. Well, happy birthday to any other birthdays that we have. Anniversaries. Said, this is the most wonderful burger I've ever had. But very thankful for that. Thank you, Brenda, for putting it together and all those who were involved.
I have an announcement.
Yes.
Speaking of putting together, if you weren't here last week, this will be news to you. It'll be a repeat for those who were here last week. And if you would like to be a willing participant to help with this celebration, I saw some of the women last week after church. If you weren't here, please see me following today. popped a question, Katie said, "I do. We wish for them the very best. God knows their love is true." They didn't want a long engagement. Long distance created another arrangement. So a trip to Mexico was due, where Katie and Eddie will both say, "I do." Please join us for a special occasion to shower the two of them with elation. Couple shower honoring Katie Anderson and Eduardo Carrillo, Saturday, August 12th, which is the next Saturday, 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock here at Antioch, and it's floating, so we're hoping everyone from Antioch and Williams will float in and float out to celebrate with them. And it's given by Antioch and Williams United Methodist Churches. The happy couple is registered at Bed Bath & Beyond in Target, so hope you can be there. And if you haven't seen me, ladies, see me after church. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have a participation by the choir.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
midst. Praying all together, Holy
God, Creator of heaven and earth, as we come before you, we are aware of our imperfect understanding of your ways and our deep need for your presence in our lives. We thank you for granting to us a family in which to grow, a people with whom we can mature. Bless you, pray, this time before we can gather to worship you and call on your name. We ask in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you, my friends. You may be seated. And I will invite the children to come forward. I have a gift. You don't know what these are, right? Oh, you're ready, that's why. You know, there was a story about Jesus that one day he was talking to some people, and he realized that there were too many. And then all of a sudden, his disciples said, "There's too many of them. Why don't you just send them away?" And he said, No. You feed them. And then they said, "Well, we only have 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish." And then Jesus said, "Well, you feed them. You know?" And the disciples said, "But how are we going to feed this multitude? We only have how many loaves? 5. And how many fish?
2.
And they were just afraid of carrying the little bit of what they have. I don't understand why they were afraid to share what they had, right? I just had a strawberry. But here's the thing. Jesus said, if you're my disciple, we need to learn to share. Right? So throughout this week, I have a task for you. And I'm going to put it to practice in a few seconds. I think that was lying. To see if you can share with others. Do you think you can do that? Yeah? So I have a box. And I think I have more people than little packets. So I'm going to give each of you 2. And you have to go and make sure that everyone shares. Can you do that? Yeah? Okay. Well, here's your two, and here's your 2. So, I'm going to give you a limited amount of time, okay? So you have to go to all the rows and make sure that at least each person gets 1. Okay? Even you. Okay? Are you ready? A gummy. Adults, we're going to need your help.
I got mine.
You got yours open?
Birthday.
you've got one gummy, raise your hand. So, kids, did everyone get a gummy? Who needs a gummy? If you need a gummy, raise your hand.
I got a gummy.
See, this is what happened with the disciples. They started scrambling around and started giving food to everyone and make sure that everyone was fed. And this is what Jesus tells us. To share the little pockets of whatever we have and share with the world. Okay? All of God's children are welcome to pray with me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For Jesus.
For Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For my family.
For my family.
And thank you.
And thank you.
For providing.
For providing.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You explain that? Look at David the Prussian. Cool. Okay. And for you adults, if you could open your Bibles on Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. If you have it, say amen. If you want to hear it from me, just hold tight. It reads, now when Jesus heard this, the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not to go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me and for me? Lord, as we come to your message and to your word, we ask that you may lean a little bit closer, speak a little bit clearer, touch our hearts and our souls so that we may understand your message for today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, and all of God's people say,
amen.
There were 3 monks that died and went to heaven as they were strolling around, and Peter went to them and asked them, "How do you like heaven?" They said, "Whoa, we like it, all right. But you know, our legs are a little bit short, so we get tired very quickly. And heaven is so vast and so big." And so Peter said, "Well, I think I could help." Later on, an angel appeared with roller skates. And then, very soon, the mice were sitting around heaven. Later on, a cat. And St. Peter went out to the cat and said, "How do you like heaven?" "Oh boy, I like heaven. I like being here. You know, it's very nice, it's fast, I can run. But you know what I like the most? Is those meals on wheels." Right. find the loaves and fishes for the some 5,000 plus women and children. It will be interesting to imagine the apostles in roller skates, just like the children sharing the first meals, dispensing the meal. But the main point is not the sight of the apostles serving the crowds, although that is a wonder considering how reluctant the apostles were to get involved in solving the problem. I think sometimes we, and people, and the world are uninterested in helping our neighbor or anybody else if it is not number one. Some communities, they don't like to get involved because at the end of the day, it is not my problem. It is not affecting me. Why should I care about them? I am very thankful for these 3 days that people were able to come together from, like I said, from different churches, different backgrounds, just different people and ages, just coming together for one sole purpose, to help families in need. The main point is not the fact that Jesus performed a miracle. The main point is that Jesus shows mercy and has compassion on the crowd. Remember, this is if you have ever had somebody who passed away, friend, family member, you are distraught. What you want to do is to get away from people. You want to just be alone and just process that loss. Well, Jesus is trying to do that. He's like, I'm going to get on the boat. I'm going to let the sea rock my boat and maybe take a nap, you know, process this loss. I just want to shut everyone off. But then he saw a great crowd following him. And I think that Jesus wants us to act in that way, that we are moved to compassion, that we are moved to acts of mercy, even when we are tired, we need to cross the things out. Jesus is saying, they need your help. Some people point out that there was no miracle involved here, but the people in the crowd all had brought their own lunches, and they had it in their pockets. When they saw the apostles starting to pass out a meager 5 loaves and 2 fish, they said, it's not going to be enough. Chicken sandwich. The theory sounds like the following story. After months of hard work and years of saving, the day came for Rob and Jack to open their own restaurant. All that was needed was a final health inspection and the issuing of a business permit. That was scheduled for the following week. Then, our place, the name of the restaurant, will be open for business. But that morning, the winds and rains of Hurricane Hugo hit, unexpectedly making its way 200 miles inland to the North Carolina town. Trees were uprooted, power lines were down, homes and stores were destroyed. Rob and Jack hurried to their restaurant to find out that everything was intact. A deputy sheriff pulled up and told them that their restaurant, the fire station next door, and a service station down the road were the only ones with electricity. Rob and Jack called the health inspector to come immediately too, so they could open, but because of the power outage, he couldn't get into his office to issue the permit. No permit, no business. With a refrigerator stocked up with 300 pounds of bacon and beef and tomatoes and lettuce and bread, there was only one thing to do. Give the food away. They told the deputy, tell your co-workers and other emergency people you see that we'll have free BLTs and coffee for anybody who wants to drop by. Soon, firemen, police, linemen, and other workers were filling into our place. When the couple heard that another restaurant was scalping people by charging $10 for two eggs, toast, and bacon, they placed a sign in the window, free BLTs, free coffee. Soon, families, travelers, and street people were welcome. Then something began to happen. People started to clean up the counters, to sweep the floors. Volunteers took over the dishwashing from Jack and helped Rob do the grill. Hearing about what was going on at our place, from the local radio station, people from neighboring towns that had not been hit so badly, they brought food from their freezers, stores, and dairies, sent over chicken, milk, foodstuff of all kinds as the day went on. Those first cups of coffee and BLT somehow stretched to 60,000 meals. The restaurant's small stock increased by 500 loaves of bread, cases of mayonnaise, 350 pots of coffee, and lots of produce. The disciples' reaction to the crowd was that of anxiety. Henry Ward Beecher says, every tomorrow has two handles. We can take hold of it with the handle of anxiety or the handle of faith. Jesus approached the problem with the handle of faith. Once Jesus started to act confidently, telling the apostles to start handling out the five loaves and two fishes, the apostles, and it seems everyone else, caught the spirit and started to pitch to help one another. I saw this faith in Brenda when she told me, you know, I don't see a lot of people sign up for Thursday and Friday. And I said, well, let's put it on the bulletin and then let's put it on again, announcement, and let's see what we can do. The way that Brenda was teaching me, was that even though it is a project, it's not a small project, it's not a painting, it's being in a house with no AC and one fan that was just making noise. I don't think there was any air being pushed from that thing. Even though there was itchiness, even though there was sunburn, even though there was dirt, even though there was hard red clay, even though the staple gun just all of a sudden got very, very hard and I could not squeeze it, people stepped up and said, I'll be there. People stepped up and said, I don't do ladders. Ladders, I mean, we have a self-respect. I don't mess with ladders, ladders don't mess with me. But I saw somebody say, okay, well, let me see if I can do this, and he just got up and went up the ladder. That's faith, to say, we're going to do this. We have not many people signed up, but we're going to do this. That is handling life with faith. Not a lot of people are quick to answer the call to help. Jesus had learned of the death of his friend John the Baptist. He had wanted to retire to a quiet place to mourn, but the crowds followed him. So many that he had to feed them. It wasn't that involving himself compassionately in feeding the crowds that Jesus found his grief fading away. We always feel better whether we are grief-stricken. Or in whatever way we are just thinking about ourselves, when we go out and help others, we're just not doing what Jesus taught us to do. We're helping ourselves, not being so focused on ourselves. One time, inconsolable. Inconsolable como. He took flowers to her every day. And during the first 3 months of mourning, he went to this priest every week. And one day the priest saw him with the flowers and he said, "Today, don't take those flowers to the grave. Take them to a hospital and give as much as you can, one flower to each patient. Do that. Just do that." The following week, the man comes in and he says, "Oh boy, I had such a great time giving away those flowers to those patients. I have made some new friends. I've been talking to some people. And actually, I cannot stay for this session for this week. I have to go with my friends." When we help others in their struggle, we forget our own struggles. There are some denominations and religions that do not allow people to take communion if they have not had their first communion, or if they're in a bad marriage, or if they're not part of their membership. And I think that's it doesn't make sense, because the table is the table of our Lord. The invitation of his name, of Jesus Christ, it is, I have been reading this passage for the past week, and I didn't see anything of Jesus excluding anyone. Or Jesus saying, "Well, you know, that person, 495, does not have a membership with me, so let's not give him all the love and fish." I didn't see Jesus saying, "Well, that person is not like me, so let's not do that. That person dresses differently than me, or speaks a different language than me. We should not do that. Let's just stay with the ones that are like me." I think Jesus showed mercy and compassion to everyone. That's the miracle. Many years ago, there was a woman who lived in a small village in France. Trained as a nurse, she devoted her life for caring for the sick and the needy. After many years of kind and selfless work, she passed away. She had no family of her own, so the town folk planned a beautiful funeral for her, a fitting tribute for the woman who so many owed their lives to her. The parish priest, however, pointed out that because she was Protestant, she could not be buried in the town's Catholic cemetery. The villagers protested, but the priest held firm. It was not easy for the priest either, because he too had been cared for by the woman during that serious illness. But the canons of the church were very clear. She would have to be buried outside the fence of the cemetery. The day of the funeral arrived, and the whole village accompanied the woman's casket to the cemetery, where she was buried outside the fence. That night, a group of villagers, armed with shovels, sneaked into the cemetery, and then quietly set to work, moving the fence over her. More astounding than Jesus feeding the crowds with a few pieces of bread and fish, is Jesus transforming the crowd into a community united in their need for one another, in the bread they share, in the love of Christ that has brought them together. Christ empowers us to perform our own miracles of creating community when we move the fences, to include outsiders, when we welcome the rejected, or forgotten to our tables, when we give of what little we have, joyfully and gratefully, for the sake of others, when we welcome one another as we will welcome Jesus. There is a theologian that said that God is everywhere. Jesus is everywhere. But most importantly, Jesus is in between each person you talk to. Every interaction with you have that you have with a person, imagine Jesus is right in between. Would you tell Jesus such things? Would you treat a person the same way that you treat Jesus? It is just a transforming understanding of how we see the world, how we treat our neighbors. Just imagine, what kind of world would it be? Any natural disaster. Churches just got together and worked together. What would happen if hungry people are being fed by the churches? And I see glimpses of what it could happen by collecting school supplies for children that maybe we don't know, for families that need it. That's when we handle life in faith. Someone has pointed out that it will be more accurate to call the story of the division of the loaves rather than the multiplication. This may seem to be a distinction without a difference, since the important point is that everyone gets fed, but there's a significant contrast. Multiplying the loaves suggests that there's just a change in quantity, whereas the dividing the loaves implies a change in quality. I don't think Jesus wants to clone Abby or Barbara and say, this is going to be what the church looks like all throughout the world. No, I think God wants us to be broken to the Holy Spirit and share what we have. Jesus makes do with what is at hand. Blessed and broken, touched by the power of God, it is these specific loaves which are now able to feed the multitude. In breaking open the bread, Jesus brings forth, as no one else could do, the possibilities and capabilities hidden in the depths of what is awaiting. God is trying to open us up. God is trying to open up the church so that people can see the transforming power of God's love in our lives. He transforms us by making us more fully ourselves, by revealing that identity of which we ourselves are not fully aware, that the unique, it is a big word, unduplicable way in which each one of us is called to be the image of God. Jesus does not want clones. Jesus wants you to be unique with yourself and be vulnerable and broken to a world that is in need. Dorothy Day started a newspaper to take up the cause of the poor. She had very little in finance, but her friend Pete convinced her that God is talking to her and convinced her to do this work. And he told her that whatever she had would be sufficient. Dorothy's newspaper staff were often upset because she was taking the money and giving it to the poor for rent, for food, for clothes. In the eyes of the staff, all these people were just cluttering up the apartment where they worked. Several times when it looked like they had no funds to go on because Dorothy had given the money away, a person would turn up to offer them a gift. It was always just enough to meet the current crisis. Each time Dorothy taught them a lesson that Christ was sufficient to meet their needs. Paul puts it this way, "My God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus our Lord." Since this is so, we are to go out to the poor in mercy and compassion, because Jesus helps and supplies every need. Because he doesn't add up. 5 loaves and 2 fish feed a multitude, doesn't add up. 12 disciples afraid and anxious and ready to send people hungry, they end up with 12 baskets full of leftovers. It doesn't add up. How many people volunteer this weekend?
It was 46.
46, it doesn't add up, but 46 people from different life paths come together to make homes for people. It doesn't add up. My math doesn't add up, but God's math in the breaking of the bread, the breaking of our lives, multiplies and extend the kingdom to people that need a helping hand. And I thank you for being able and vulnerable to the moving of the Holy Spirit in the world. Because what you did this weekend, it is because the Holy Spirit is moving within your life to help a world that is in need. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. Would you stand with me and open your hymnals on page 393, Spirit of the Living God. The good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
My friends, let us get out of our pews and greet one another in the peace. Thank you. we have our moments of gratitude. So, what are we thankful for this morning?
Cool weather.
Yes.
Family and friends.
Family and friends. I went to a family meeting in the spirit yesterday. And actually, one of my cousins remembered Eduardo. She worked at Fairham College and said it was really wonderful to see relatives.
Places where they don't know the people, and just digging a hole, putting on mulch, people putting the staples, and Julie's stapler was, for people who knew what to do. Said, Eduardo, can you reach down? I'm very thankful for a community that cares and that is willing to be opened up and broken by the Holy Spirit to go out in a world that needs it. And if we have, do we have any names to give in? Yeah, Abby, could you go?
Let us live.
It does, doesn't it? Let us lift these names in prayer, these people that are in great need. And that's why they're on the prayer list. And prayer for all of those here, too. Devin, Zach, Baby Brady, unspoken prayers. Molly Epperson, Wayne and Dessa Kendrick, Pauline and Corey Ratliff, Ron Stone, Jenny Arthur, Thelma Fallon, Margaret Wilkerson, Jean Keelan, Lord, hear all of our prayers. Kathy and Lee Barnhill, Dorothy Shields, Gail Grant, Caroline West, Ashby Murray, Lydia, Mike, Natalie Pearson, Wendy Ripperer, Dorothy Driscoll, May Overby, Molly Epperson, Lord, hear our prayers. Lois Raba, Chrissy Linkletter, teachers and students. Betty King, Aloysia Brooks, Kaylee Kelly and Joel Meeks, John and Edna Best, and Joe Coleman. Lord, hear our prayers.
And I want to invite, if you are a teacher, a professor, working in the school system, to come forward. We want to have a prayer for you and consecrate you as this year starts. And so if you are a worker in the system, a teacher, come to the front. My friends, these are people who are influencing the lives of young people, of young adults, and I think that when you have a good teacher, you can make a difference in communities. And so as we have them in our prayers. Let us, yes, we have a letter. Keep them in your prayers because not every child is like our child perfect, but sometimes they are troublemakers. And those troubles, most of the time, are because they don't have a stable home. So keep them in your prayers as well. And as you're sitting over there, I just want you to reach out towards them, and just bless them. Just bless them as I pray, all right? Lord, we thank you for the lives that these people are going to be touching. We ask that you give them of your peace, of your love, of your care, that they may be able to show the Holy Spirit in their actions, in their words, that your calmness and your peace may be upon their hearts. That sometimes, every day, day in and day out, means a constant battle, but we know that they are doing what you call them to do, to influence the lives of young people. And we thank you for their lives and their ministry and their call in their life. Thank you for letting us have them in our midst. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, and all of God's people say,
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, my friends. And as the ushers come forward, I will ask that we may put our hearts according to the will of God, and that we may do it with great joy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise to your name and join their unending hymns.
Holy, holy, holy Lord. God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism, his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, O God, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of this, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. And on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, with the confidence of forgiven, broken, you children of God, let us pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
My friends, the invitation has been sent. You are invited to come to the table. The table is set. Christ the Lord makes the invitation, and you are welcome to come as you are. So we'll start from this side, then we'll go. So as you are feeling the Spirit, come on over and partake of communion. Susan, can you come? Remember that God has offered this without price. God has broken for us. God has shed his blood on us. Go and be Christ for the world. Amen. Thank you. Take of this act. Has anybody missing? Everybody took bread. All right. I don't want communion to go without everyone being part, or at least being close to the table. So, would you stand with me in our, and open your hymnals in page 314 in the garden? Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.